Meet the MIT Lottery Group. If anything involving numbers involves student from MIT, aka the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, you know those guys are going to figure it out. There was the famous blackjack team that ran from late 1979 through to 1989 that was well documented and made into a movie. However, not many people know about this MIT team that cracked a lottery. Just how did a team of former MIT students figure how to beat the lottery hundreds of times? In 2005, James Harvey was at the end of his time at MIT, where he was finishing up his math degree. He needed a project for his final semester in school. He stumbled on lotteries during his research for a topic. Harvey began analyzing well-known lottery games such as the Powerball and Mega Millions. Those lotteries were big lotteries with big prizes, which is something that attracted all sorts of players. But he soon became intrigued by a lottery called Cash WinFall. This was a new game that was introduced in Massachusetts in 2004, and it was only in Massachusetts, limiting the player pool. The rules were simple for this lottery. Players could choose six numbers for each ticket, and each ticket costs just $2. At the beginning of the lottery, if a ticket matched all six numbers in the draw, the ticket holder won a jackpot of at least $500,000. And if a ticket matched some, but not all the numbers, a ticket would win a little bit of money. The lottery was designed so that for every dollar played, 60 cents would be paid out in prizes. This, of course, is a losing proposition in the long run. The rest of the 40 cents of that dollar would just be spent on whatever the government deemed was needed in the local community, just as usual. Cash WinFall seemed to be just like all the other lottery games that were available. If no one won in a particular week, that prize would just roll over to be combined with next week's prize, something that plenty of other lotteries had as well. However, the problem for lotteries with rollovers is that there are times when no one wins for a very long time. Lottery officials worry that if no one appears for a long time in the local newspaper or local TV station with a giant check, people stop playing because they don't see people winning. And because of that, they stopped playing. The Massachusetts Lottery faced precisely that challenge in 2003. Its Mass Millions game went without a winner for an entire year, and ticket sales fell. Lottery officials didn't want the same thing to happen with Cash WinFall. So, lottery officials decided on a big change. Instead of rolling over the prize money when no one won, they instead would roll down the prize money. Basically, this means that there would be a guaranteed winner once the prize grew to a certain amount. And this rule change was the key to everything. If the prize rose to $2 million without a winner, that triggered a roll down. The jackpot would be split among the players who had matched 3, 4, or 5 numbers. Before each drawing, Cash WinFall would publish its estimate for the jackpot, which was based on the ticket sales from previous draws. When the estimated jackpot reached $2 million, players knew that someone had to win. Lottery players intuitively realized that the odds of winning money were far better in a roll-down week than at any other time. This meant that ticket sales always surged, something that was exactly what lottery officials wanted. It didn't take long for Harvey to calculate that the expected value to play Cash WinFall was better than any other lotteries. This just means that it was actually profitable to play the lottery, although it doesn't mean wins are guaranteed. When a roll down happened, there was at least a 15% return for every dollar paid. The big risk here was the 1.4% chance that the jackpot would be won, and that means no one else would get paid out. For Harvey, his only problem was capital. That, and how long his group could play the game. In February of 2005, Harvey formed a lottery group with some of his fellow MIT students. Roughly 50 people chipped in for the first batch of tickets. They raised $1,000 total for that round. Although they didn't win the big one, Harvey's calculation proved to be correct. The MIT group tripled their money the first week they played in the Cash WinFall lottery. And that's how Harvey's life completely changed. Over the next few years, playing the lottery became a full-time job for him. Cash WinFall had become the most profitable lottery in the US. By 2010, he and fellow team member Yuran Liu officially made it into an incorporated business. They named it Random Strategies Investments LLC. This was named after the smallest dorm at MIT, a dorm that Harvey lived in. During the summer of 2010, the Cash WinFall jackpot again approached the roll-down limit. After a prize of $1.59 million went unclaimed on August 12th, the lottery estimated that the jackpot for the next round would be around $1.68 million. The roll-down was at least two maybe 3 weeks away. By the end of the month, the jackpot would be almost guaranteed. But for some reason, the roll down came the very next week instead. There had been a huge increase in ticket sales that week, triggering the roll down. Lottery officials were just as surprised as the players, and the fact that a betting group would corner the market was something that they had anticipated. Still, they had never sold that many tickets in a week before. When Cash WinFall was first introduced, lottery officials researched the possibility of someone deliberately triggering a roll down by buying up a big number of tickets. They calculated that a player who used stores' automated lottery machines would be able to churn out about 100 tickets with random numbers per minute. If a jackpot had less than $1.7 million, that player would need to buy over 500,000 tickets to push it above the $2 million limit, because that would take well over 83 hours, and that's if they did it over 83 hours nonstop, something that was impossible. The lottery didn't think anyone would be able to do it in time at $1.7 million, but they didn't properly take into consideration the lengths certain betting groups would go to, specifically the MIT lottery team. When Harvey first started doing lottery research in 2005, he tried to get a copy of the guidelines for the official rules of the game. He was looking for rules that outlined just exactly how prize money was distributed. A whopping 3 years later, in 2008, the lottery finally sent him what he had requested. The information was what pushed him and the group into overdrive, because they had the exact calculation instead of just the models they had come up with. The group figured out that their time to strike was when the jackpot failed to top $1.6 million. That was the magic number where they figured that they can realistically start their push of buying tickets. The unexpected surge lottery officials saw that second week of August in 2010 was a methodically planned out operation by Harvey's group. They had been planning all year for it. In fact, they had been planning the prior year too. The MIT lottery group had to fill out around 700,000 tickets. Here's the crazy part. They did it all by hand. 700,000 tickets by hand. However, their efforts paid off. It's estimated that the group made around $750,000 that week. Unfortunately for Harvey and his partners, the profits didn't continue for that much longer, at least in that particular lottery. Within a year, the Boston Globe's Andrea Estes had discovered that Cash WinFall could have been gamed by sophisticated mathematicians. She went ahead and wrote about it in the paper. That news report prompted Gregory Sullivan, Massachusetts Inspector General, to do research into the lottery in 2011. Sullivan concluded that the actions of the MIT Lottery Group and other betting syndicates were entirely legal, and that no one's odds of having a winning ticket were affected by high-volume betting. But the game was gradually phased out anyways. Even if Cash WinFall had not been phased out, the game wouldn't have remained profitable because of the publicity it received. That was simply because of the fact that after the news report came out, people started forming more and more betting groups. As more people bought tickets in roll-down weeks, prizes were split into smaller and smaller chunks. That meant the ROI shrunk, since it was a zero-sum game. At the beginning, during normal weeks, picking 5 out of 6 numbers correctly meant a $4,000 win. During a roll-down week, that prize was anywhere from $20,000 to $40,000. The amount depended on how many winning tickets were cashed. Fewer winning tickets translates to larger payouts. For example, in Cash WinFall's first year, the prize for picking 5 numbers correctly once exceeded $100,000. The MIT betting team anticipated the competitive environment and made their move to corner the market earlier to obtain an edge over other teams. The MIT group also had a better understanding of the game, better than any of their competitors. They knew the exact payoffs and probabilities because of the information from the lottery officials themselves. However, the MIT group also knew that their approach would mean that large betting groups would catch on and start buying tickets as well. They knew that it would become a race to the bottom. Surprisingly, the MIT team wasn't the leading winners in Cash WinFall game in 2010. They were second in amount of money won. The group that made the most money is called GS Investment Strategies, which was run by Gerald and Marjorie Selby. They made almost $1 million in just that blackjack game that year. Jerry and Marge have actually roughly made $26 million in profit from playing the lottery. Then there was just the matter of logistics. The MIT team had handwritten all the tickets and it took them roughly a year to do it. And just because there was a machine at a store, there was the matter of convincing store clerks to print out hundreds of tickets at a time. There were plenty of stores that would refuse to serve teams altogether. However, on the other hand, there were some store owners that made it a priority to sell to teams. That's because they got a commission equal to 5% of the lottery sales. And even if someone was able to get on a machine, there were other problems. The ticket machine would jam in humid weather, and if the machine was low on ink, that slowed down the printer a lot. Then there are all the other random issues that theoretically can pop up in buying lots of lottery tickets, such as getting robbed. There was also the question of how to store and organize all the tickets they bought. Harvey had to keep millions of losing tickets in boxes in order to show audits if it happened, and it was a giant headache to find winning tickets. Betting groups are not new. They've long used the tactic of brute force attacks to beat lotteries. The only real obstacle is buying enough tickets. It's more a question of manpower than mathematics, and this reduces the exclusivity of the methods. However, Harvey knew this coming in, and that's why they took the time to meticulously outthink and outmaneuver their competition. Even with their edge, though, Harvey knew that it couldn't last forever. He realized at some point, the sheer legwork to win this particular lottery could not outweigh the money he could have made doing something else. To this day, there are still gambling groups that operate around the world that have managed to repeatedly and legally beat whatever games they play into a profit. From 2004 to 2011, professional gambling groups spent about $40 million on Cash WinFall to win roughly $48 million. That $40 million in extra tickets worked out to around $16 million extra dollars for the lottery fund. Who were the big losers? The average player, of course. Here's what's next.